Welcome to Campus, the university sports magazine, with the best moments from the Universiade in Kazan. In part two, we focus on rowing and on fencing with Yannick Borel, a winner with the Epee. And in part three, we follow the French Rugby Sevens team on their way to the final, plus a look ahead to Guangzhou and the next summer Universiade. So this was the 27th Summer Universiade in Kazan, the capital of the Republic of Tatarstan in the Russian Federation. Kazan had worked on the project since 2008 with the mission to gather young athletes from all over the world in the city of unique multi-ethnic heritage. Mission accomplished. There are many positive aspects. First of all, I'd like to say that the number of athletes and officials who lived in a magnificent university village, that was a great success. Lots of competitions of a very high level too. We had 67 university records. We also had success in the number of spectators watching the competitions. We sold 800,000 tickets. We had wonderful opening and closing ceremonies that were followed and broadcast around the world. All in all, the Universiade was a really big success. It was the first high-profile multi-sport event in Russia since the collapse of the Soviet Union, and Russian athletes with 292 medals were the most successful team, as Kazan continued the nation's sporting tradition and became a launchpad for future generations of athletes. Kazan really showed that FISU and the organizing committee are able to organize such an important multi-sport event. I think that the depth of talent and the high quality of the athletes demonstrated that the competition is really the second most important multi-sport event in the world. There is no question of that. The Summer Universiade normally consists of 10 compulsory sports with 13 compulsory disciplines and up to 3 optional sports chosen by the host country. But there is some concern that the program has perhaps become too big, and FISU have acted accordingly. We at FISU realized that after the development of the Universiades with 26 sports in Shenzhen and then 27 sports here in Kazan, which were really great during these last few years, that we want to control that growth. So, in Guangzhou, we'll have 21 sports. In Taipei, after that, we'll have 20 or 22 sports. And we hope that due to these measures, we'll see other candidate cities interested in organizing the next Universiades in the future. Meanwhile, the city of Kazan is reaping the rewards of the legacy. 20 venues from the University Games will be used by educational institutions. The life of Kazan citizens will become more diverse for people of all ages. There's now the chance of playing any kind of sport they like and live a healthy life. Kazan is really the perfect example of how to develop sports infrastructure, sports and all the other infrastructure of the city from the bidding process onwards. When you speak to the inhabitants of Kazan, they tell you that their daily life has completely changed since the preparation process of the Universiade began. Kazan is one of the largest economic, scientific and cultural centers in the whole Russian Federation, and it was certainly successful in promoting FISU's motto of excellence in mind and body. Aliya Mustafina, the 2010 World Individual All-Around Gymnastics Champion and Olympic Champion on the Uneven Bars, and the reigning European Champion as well, so no surprise that she helped Russia to win the team competition in the Universiade. Tatina Nabieva excelled in the vaults. Ksenia Afanseva, wonderful on the floor. And Anna Dementieva excelled on the beam. Japan taking team silver, helped by Mitsuo Naga. And a good performance by Sakura Noda on the vault as well. The young German gymnast Pia Tolly helped her country to third place in the team competition. The teammate Kim Bui finished ninth in the German team in the London Olympics. She didn't fail them here. And Annabelle Holzer producing a solid performance on the beam. Pia Tolly, just 18 years of age, well satisfied with her performance. So with a score of 162.05, Germany taking bronze behind Japan on 165 dead. But the Russians won the team title by quite a margin, a total score of 175.5. In the men's competition, Russia also dominant, beating Ukraine and Japan. Nikolai Kuzenkov, a great support for the Russian team. He won gold for the second time in the individual all-around as well, 2 years after Shenzhen. And he took a third gold medal on the pommel horse. Nikolai Kuzenkov. The women's individual all-around, the winner, Alia Mustafina, beating Ksenia Afanasieva and Germany's Kim Bui into second and third place. Mustafina, the most successful gymnast in the university, had topping the podium on the uneven bars. After four exercises, her score 57.9. Afanasieva would be brilliant on the floor, claiming the gold medal, and the silver in the individual overall with 56.85. And for Germany's Kim Bui, the bronze in the individual all-around event. Back to the men, and in the individual all-around, David Belyavsky, the bronze medalist, taking another bronze on the floor, as the Russian men collected a total of four golds, three silvers, and two bronze. An impressive result in front of their home crowd. Among the spectators at the University Games, the rhythmic gymnastics star Anna Kanaeva. And telling everybody, first of all, the competitions here are terrific, the atmosphere is amazing, the Universiade, certainly one of my favorite athletics events. I was always happy to take part in the University Games, so I'm happy to be here. And Kanaeva would watch one of Russia's up-and-coming stars in rhythmic gymnastics, Margarita Mamun, impressing everybody, the 17-year-old receiving 18.566 with her performance with the ribbon. She'd gone to win the individual all-around. The all-around silver went to another Russian, Alexandra Merkulova. She won the gold in the ball event and silver with the ribbon. The Ukrainian Ganaritsa Dinova became bronze medalist in the individual all-around competition. She took third place in the hoop and the ball and second spot with the clubs. The general level of the competition here is really quite high. All the number one gymnasts from different countries like Ukraine, Belarus, Korea, and of course Russia are taking part in these games. As well as winning the all-around title, Margarita Mamun also took gold in the women's ribbon, hoop and clubs, a total of four gold medals in a top-quality program combined with terrific elegance. The European champion with the ribbon certainly has huge potential. But these Russian performances, no surprise to the Olympic champion of 2012. Russian athletes are winning a lot of competitions, partly because these games are taking place in Kazan. Each federation, each Russian federation sends their best competitors here. They're very well prepared for the University Games because, you know, their goal is to get the highest possible results in front of the home fans. They're doing a great job. We're proud of them. The Russians winning another 3 golds during the summer Universiad, and that success certainly something to do with the great career of Evgenia Kanayeva. Her achievement, a shining example for a lot of young girls in Russia in a sport that she's promoting hard. I hope that after my interview with her, kids will want to try out the sports disciplines themselves, and their parents will take them to a gymnastics school or another sports school, perhaps. My primary goal is the promotion of sport in my country and abroad as well. Kanayeva holds the record for the most world titles ever, a total of 17, with 13 European titles. And she has 9 University Games gold medals as well, but she hasn't competed since London Olympics. Will she be back? I haven't stopped my career entirely. I've just taken a break. When I make a final decision to continue or not, I'll let you know. Well, whether Evgenia will be back or not, she is for sure more than a role model. Kanayeva is something of an iconic figure for the University Games. Watching Campus in part two, we'll focus on rowing and meet the Frenchman Yannick Barel, a gold medalist in team fencing. Stay with us. Times you hurt me, treated me wrong. Something you had to give to solve this thing.
You touch, it tells. T-Touch 2 Diamonds. Tactile technology. Tissot.
University Games, and at the Kazan Rowing Center, they fought for 13 gold medals. The women's double sculls final, the Lithuanians, Pristate and Valtsyukat, beating the Belarusian pair, Kota and Shlupska, with the Ukrainian rowers, Kavchenko and Olena Burich, in third place. The Ukrainian, Natalia Dovotko, was the fastest in the single sculls final in front of the Czech, Yitka Antasova and Eliza Kulba from Latvia. The German Cockless Four-boat took the gold medal ahead of Italy and Russia. In the men's lightweight double Cockless final, the Germans took their second gold medal, this time beating France and Japan. Germany would finish second in the medal table with a total of 4, behind Russia with 7. The women's lightweight single sculls, the South African Kirsty McCann the fastest. Russia's Olga Arkadova took the silver medal and the Italian Eleonora Trivella got the bronze. To the men's lightweight single scull final, and Yule Special leading from the start for Germany's third gold in rowing. Jerzy Kowalski of Poland finished second, ahead of the Hungarian Gabor Csepregi. In the women's cockless fours, it was the Russians first, South Africa second, and the Ukraine third. The men's cockless pair final saw another gold for Russia. This time the Ukrainians getting silver, with the French pair Jean Nourry and Hugo Laborde grabbing the bronze. France taking just 2 medals in the rowing events. The men's double sculls final, the Lithuanians beating Ukraine and Russia. the third gold medal for Lithuania, and third place in the medal table. In the men's lightweight double sculls, the Austrian brothers, Paul and Bernard Sieber, were unbeatable. Kamara and Kovalov taking silver for Ukraine, the eighth medal for their country. They were followed by the Italians, Molteni and Barbaro. And in the men's eight, the Russians coming home in front of Ukraine and the Netherlands, the seventh medal for Russia, the best rowing nation of the Kazan Universiade. Yannick Borel is a French fencer. He competed in the individual épée at the London Olympics and came fifth. And now, he was the French flag bearer at the Universiade in Kazan, an unforgettable experience for him. Well, it was certainly a big honor to be chosen as the flag bearer, so of course I really wanted to be an example for the others. Although, in fact, the girls had showed us an example beforehand, so we really were following their example. And we finally succeeded in winning here as well. Certainly to be a flag bearer was a big responsibility. Borel won the gold medal with the French team at the 2011 World Championships, so he came to Kazan with some ambition. He was there with the French women when they took gold before he also became a Universiade champion. Well, me, I take it like a university world title, so it's important. It has a big value for me, and not only for me, you know, I think a lot of countries that were here wanted to have this medal to bring the gold medal back home, but we really fought for it, and we wanted this medal so much. We didn't want to leave without it. We certainly didn't want to leave with a different one. We were expected to do well, and we did it. It's really super. It wasn't so easy to succeed. Yannick Borel took part in the Belgrade Universiade in 2009, and now 4 years later, more experienced, managing the pressure well, and unbeatable during the men's final against China's Chen Yang Jiang. Here it's rather like the Olympic Games, really. So many nations are present. We see each other sometimes, and, you know, everybody here has his own goal. You've got to stay focused on your own goal. I think it's very helpful to experience a level of competition like this before you go to the Olympic Games. Borel certainly in form, even beating the individual épée winner, Chao Dong, sweeping France to that gold medal. But Borel chose fencing because it's an individual sport, a passion from his childhood. When I was 10 years of age, I discovered fencing at school and I liked it a lot. There are a lot of competitions, and for me, I come from Guadeloupe. Well, it gave me a chance of traveling to South America and around the West Indies. So I appreciated this sport. I was motivated, and I never gave up. The strategy certainly paying off. The Frenchman now one of the very best. My goal is really to go to Rio and take a medal there, but I'm not thinking about that all the time. It's too early. I have to take it slowly, stage by stage, step by step. Yannick Borel does not lack ambition, but he's learned to be patient and enjoy the journey. After the break, the French rugby sevens team on their way to the final, and a look ahead to Guangzhou, the host city of the next Summer Universiade in 2015. Times you hurt me, treated me wrong.
Something you had to give to solve this thing going on. You touch, it tells. T-Touch 2 Diamonds. Tactile technology. Tissot.
Rugby Sevens made its debut at the Summer Universiade in Kazan, and the French team were among the favourites for the title. The players, all members of Rugby 15 professional clubs, but Rugby Sevens will feature for the first time at the Rio Olympic Games. And the Summer Universiad gave them an opportunity to form a Rugby Sevens team with the Olympics in mind. It's great what's happening, really. It's the first time that Rugby Sevens has been present at the Universiad. It's the first time this sport has been part of a multi-sport event for the preparation of the Olympic Games. It's really interesting. Well, in Pool D, France showed their superiority. Italy couldn't stand the pressure, losing 24-12. France then beat Brazil 36-0, Romania 19-12, and Poland in the quarterfinals. French coach wanted more. The goal we've set before coming here was a gold medal. It's an ambitious goal. The French players preparing for the semi-final against Great Britain. A revenge match for France after their semi-final defeat by the British in the University World Championship of 2012. Sylvain Motti again, the French coach. We came to Kazan in order to prepare our system of play. We've got very high goals, but we knew that to achieve that we had to be in the Final Four. That was attainable for us, and we knew we had to play against Britain. So here it is then, the British against the French for a place in the final. Supported by their fans, France having a good start, fighting hard and building a tremendous lead, 19 points to nil at one stage. They knew that if they beat the British, they had a great chance of taking the final. Final score was here in the semi, 25-7. Well, the French were thrilled, and they were going to celebrate in their own particular fashion. Well, afterwards, as usual, the players take an icy bath that calms them down immediately. And then they'll take time out in the village in order to celebrate a little bit, an hour or so. Then they'll eat something and watch some videos in the evening. Well, the French team would play the final against Russia the next day. Tough final, as it turned out. Russia had won all their previous matches quite easily. South Africa were beaten by them in the semi-finals, but the French were doing their homework. We're working on videos of the Russian game. We'll proceed like before every match. We establish a precise plan that we've worked on together. We know they're aggressive. The rest of it really is up to the players themselves. They're ready to go. They are ready to go. Ready there, Mayor Bim, but it wouldn't be enough. The Russian team composed of professional rugby sevens players, and France without their best player, out injured. The Russians winning 29-19, their final gold of the Universiade, and frustration for the French and their captain. Well, you know, yesterday we had a great match against Great Britain because we dominated. This time it was the contrary. We were exhausted because we were obliged to defend a lot of the time, so it's finished. It's sad, frankly. But France take the silver medal and the thought that they'll have their chance again at the upcoming Olympic Games in Rio in 2016. Well, the Summer Universiade of Kazan is over. And next, it'll be Gwangju 2015, the South Korean city getting ready to reach out to the young people of the world. The key word for Gwangju is EPIC. EPIC, an acronym symbolizing Gwangju's special dedication to the Universiade. It stands for Eco-Friendliness, Peace, IT, and Culture. Well, we're expecting from the 2015 Games that firstly, the promotion of FISU, the International Federation of University Sports, and its ideals will continue. Secondly, that other candidate cities will want to bid for 2021. And more generally speaking, that the level of participation of our member countries in Asia will continue. We had 159 participating countries in Kazan, and I hope that for Gwangju, we'll have the same number of member countries and athletes taking part there.
Autant de pays membres et autant d'athlètes qui sont là.
and Gwangju has officially started its countdown as the next host city. In full preparation mode and looking forward to welcoming athletes from all over the world for the next Summer Universiade. And that was Campus.